Yeah, thank you for the invitation. I'm really happy to talk at this conference in the honor of Dirk, whom I met actually about 30 years ago when he was still a PhD student of Jürgen Körner in Mainz. At the time, we had a joint interest in the gamma 5 problem of dimensional equalization.
He was a student of Karl Schilcher.
Oh, Schilcher, officially, yeah. I was visiting Jürgen Körner at the time. Jürgen.
Please, could you click on the way to have a full screen? Could you click on the green button to have full screen? Yes, better.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah, I met Dirk 30 years ago and at those days, in fact, from what I remember, nobody thought that Feynman diagrams were something very interesting mathematically. It was something very tedious and that had to be done, but nobody thought that there was any interesting mathematics in it. Now, 30 years later, Feynman diagrams have turned into something like a gold mine for pure mathematicians. And I think everybody here agrees that Dirk has a lot of credit in this. Yeah. So today I'm going to talk about, not really about a lot of algebraic matters, but about my own specialty, which is world line integration. So for those who don't, where is it coming up double? Anyway, a few words of history for those who don't know about the world line formalism. The world line formalism is an alternative to Feynman diagrams, and it's as old as Feynman diagrams themselves, because Feynman invented world line partial integrals at the same time when he invented also Feynman diagrams. In fact, it seemed that he used them as a guiding principle for finding Feynman diagrams. And then when he had Feynman diagrams, he was so happy with them that he basically forgot about all those relativistic path integrals. So let's start with scalar QED and with the Green's function and X space for the Klein-Gordon operator. We have to work in Minkowski, in Euclidean space, and many people know probably that you can exponentiate the propagator and then convert it into a quantum mechanical path integral, which is
maybe just you could try, if you go to the menu bar, maybe in the view you can change to single page view. If you go with your mouse to the I'm not familiar with Tech Shop. If you just open it with
should be the preview, yes.
You can use preview display format in the Tech Shop menu. You go to preview display format.
Okay.
And then full screen.
It still comes double.
No.
Well, let me go full screen like this. Is that okay?
Yeah, I think that's better actually that way then. Yeah, I think
okay,
that's better.
Let's go back to Feynman's work in 1950. In modern notation, he constructs a path integral representing the propagator of a scalar particle in Euclidean X space, going from X prime to X, and over time T, and one has to integrate over all paths connecting X prime and X in Euclidean space time. And that's what's nowadays called the photon dressed propagator, and it's a Feynman diagram, it is down here. But it will be important for the following, that the photons are not ordered. Yeah, the photons have a fixed momentum, a fixed number, but it is not fixed in which order they actually arrive, yeah? Or be emitted. Yeah, well, here we, this could either be the propagator in an external field, or you can convert it into the amplitude with n photons, specializing the field to plane waves. If you do the same thing for the one loop effective action, you start with a trace log of the Klein-Gordon operator, and then instead of paths that go from X prime to X in space time, you have to integrate over all closed paths in space time. And again, if you leave the external field general, then it's effective action. You expand the field in plane waves, then you get the one loop and photon amplitudes. And now the structure of QED is so simple that it's quite obvious that just from these two elements, connecting photons in pairs, you will be able to construct the complete QED S matrix. Yeah? And since QED doesn't really have non-trivial symmetry factors, there's also no problem with overcounting, which would actually be an issue in phi to four theory. Yeah? And Feynman himself, 1 year later, generalized this to spinor QED. So he found what is called the Feynman spin factor. So you start with scalar QED, and then for a fixed path, you insert along that path, you insert that spin factor here, you calculate its trace, and that gives you the contribution of spin. And after the invention of Grassmann path integrals, Fratkin, 25 years later, found the more modern way of presenting the spin factor in terms of a Grassmann path integral. Why do we prefer this? For two reasons. First, you don't have to pass order. Yeah, that will be very important. You don't have to fix an ordering of the legs along the loop. And moreover, it makes a supersymmetry manifest between the orbital and spin degrees of freedom, which in quantum mechanics we have already with the Pauli equation, but in the standard Dirac approach, actually get somewhat hidden in quantum field theory. Now, these path integrals were not much used for calculations until the late 80s, when people had learned in string theory how to some methods of calculating path integrals, Grassmann integrals, use worksheet supersymmetry, etc. So Polyakov, Born and Kosover, Strassler did some work that eventually led to the idea that one should calculate such path integrals like in a one-dimensional perturbation theory. That means the orbital path integral should be calculated using a Green's function that is for the ordinary second derivative, but adapted to the proper time circumference that fixes the periodicity. And the chi path integral that represents the spin factor should be calculated using a Green's function, that's just the signum function, and effectively contains all the manipulations that normally you do with Dirac matrices. So in a way, those psi functions are like the Dirac matrices, but they are kind of flexible and not bound to appear in any fixed ordering. That's the way we look at it nowadays. Now in going back to scalar QAD, if you want to do this explicitly, you go back to the one loop effective action, you put the field in terms of plane waves, you expand, you take out the terms that contain every of the n polarizations and moment ones, the total, what we call the totally mixed terms. That's just a low tech way of doing Fourier transformation. And then you get the one loop n photon amplitude in a representation where each photon is represented by a vertex operator and is integrated along the trajectory. And it's very important that at one loop, you have here a problem that before doing your path integral, you must actually fix a zero mode, which is the zero mode is, tells you that you could actually change a loop just by translating it without changing the Wörthrian action. So that would be a flat direction for your Gaussian path integral. So you have to fix that. And that eventually will just produce energy momentum conservation. And then to actually, well, at this stage, your path integral is already Gaussian, yeah, because the orbital x of tau coordinate appears only linearly and exponentially. To get at a closed formula, you do this little exponentiation trick that's also well known from string theory. And then you do the Gaussian integration formally. In flat space, you can do that formally. You never run into problems. In curved space, it's a bit more tricky. You get what is called a Born-Kosova master formula. So you have the one loop n photon amplitude and scalar QED written in a way where you have the here's the global proper time of the particle, the scalar particle in the loop. You have still one integration for each photon, also one of them is redundant. And then you have this exponential, which is kind of fake because eventually these guys will have to be expanded out and you will have to take the terms linear in all the, in each polarization. But the important thing is that it contains only these Wörthrian-Kriens function G and its derivatives. Yeah. And those who haven't seen this before should take note that we have a delta function appearing here. Now, this is a very nice formula because it's a one-line formula having the full information on the one-loop and photon amplitude. It's valid off-shell, that means you can use it for going to higher loop orders by sewing. Very important to write it down. We did not have to fix the ordering of the photons along the loop. Born and Kosova found also that this formula has information on the cases where the scalar becomes a spinner or even a gluon. These are the famous Born and Kosova rules. And Strassler actually investigated more the case of QED itself and studied what happens when you actually remove all the quartic vertices. Yes. These delta functions that create Seagull vertices, which obviously we have in scalar QED. And in spinner QED, normally we don't have them, but here we have them because effectively we are using a second order formalism. But in any case, you can remove them. And that after that, the integrand becomes actually much nicer. Which is also kind of familiar nowadays from things like KKLT or double copy. Many, many nice things, nice algorithms start working only when you remove all quartic or higher vertices and everything becomes trivalent. let's look at the four photon case. Either scalar or spin QED. It does make very little difference here. So normally we would have, like in spin QED, we would have a sum of six permuted Feynman diagrams, and scalar QED some more with the Siegel vertices. In the Wurzeln formalism, if we just use the master formula in a straightforward way, we would, in fact, be doing more or less the same as doing an ordinary Feynman diagram calculation using Schwinger parameters. It would be the same amount of algebraic work, the same type of integrals, the same tensor reduction. So that wouldn't be a very interesting thing to do. The formalism becomes interesting only when you use the freedom to actually do something with these integrals. And what you can do is you can massage them by a large number of integration by parts. And then they actually reduce to five tensor structures, which actually are already gauge invariant. So here we introduce a field strength tensor for each of the four photons. And here you have the traces of products of field strength tensors. And then here you have some chains of field strength tensors. And it is very curious that exactly this basis of five tensors was found in 1971 by Costandini et al. Using the QED water identity. So they started writing down the 138 tensors, which you can write down at 4 point, and then systematically reduced using the QED water density and permutation invariance. It is very curious that we, just by integration by parts, generated exactly the same basis, just trying to write the integrand as compact as possible. So in this basis, the coefficient function for spinner QED are these five here. You see they involve in the exponent, you still have the Green's function G. In the prefactor, you have only the first derivative, you don't have the second derivative anymore. And moreover, the part that comes from the spin factor always appears in these combinations. Yeah, you have always closed cycles of indices and then a difference of an orbital term and a spin term. And that is actually related to the Wurzeln supersymmetry and was first derived by Bern and Kosova. And this combines the cases of spinner and scalar QED. If you want to go to scalar QED, you just delete all the terms that have a GF. So this is actually a recent result. Previously, we did not have such a compact version, and we also didn't have that reduction to the tensor basis. This is work we have in progress. We use this for the first calculation of the four photon amplitudes totally off shell, which was never done. In fact, that work by Costandini et al. There they calculate with two legs off shell and two on shell. So we do that in general kinematics, as well as with one or two photons taken in the low energy limit. And also, not only the integration, but also the tensor reduction is actually a kind of really adjusted to the Wurzeln formalism. Yeah. Our guiding principle is we never want to really split the amplitude into ordered sectors. So we cannot use tensor reduction algorithms because all of them work only once you have fixed the ordering of the external legs. So we have to invent a method that actually works without fixing them. So why, what is the motivation for this? Well, this is not really the workshop to talk about this, but for example, in G minus two calculations, where they are now going to 6 and 7 loops, the light by light subdiagrams figure very prominently, they're important, yeah? And having nice simple formulas for them, which do not make it necessary to fix the ordering of the legs, could be quite important. Moreover, you can also use the one-loop photon amplitudes, of course, to go to higher orders in the photon propagator. Like many years ago already, we constructed, with Michael Schmidt, we constructed the two-loop diagrams for what normally would be these three diagrams in the Wortland formalism, and managed to calculate the two-loop Wiedler function without encountering any non-trivial integrals, and actually also without having to split into these two different topologies. Eh? Also, we never managed to carry this onto the three-loop case. We still would like to do that. In fact, when we all met at the multi-loop workshop in Aspen 1995. That was there, David Protost, Chaturkin, Andrei Davidichev. In fact, the three-loop and higher-loop photon propagator and its Wiedler function was a very big topic. At the time, what had been calculated is the four-loop Wiedler function in spinner QAD, and David just had calculated the three-loop Wiedler function scalar QAD, and in both scalar and spinner QAD, it so happens that a three-loop, so theta three contributions that canceled out, and at four-loop, in the spinner QAD case, there also theta fives that canceled out. So at the time, everybody was convinced that the QAD beta function at the quenched level was rational. And David Dirk and Bob Del Borgo even constructed kind of a proof. But then years later, actually the Karlsruhe group calculated the five-loop coefficient, and there was some theta three that just refused to go away. And so we know the cancellations are not complete, but that's still, I think this, the puzzle why did they happen in the first place is still unresolved and worth thinking about. In fact, just this week I was in contact with Jonathan Rosner, who had actually calculated the three-loop QED beta function, and he told me that he would still very much like to know why theta three cancels out. Now, why is it difficult to apply the Wortland formalism to this kind of problem? That is because the advantage of having all the diagrams in one big integral is unfortunately somewhat, let's say, formal. As long as you don't know how to calculate integrals that have absolute values in the exponent, yeah, don't try to give Mathematiker integrals which have absolute values in the exponent. For example, computers are not good at this kind of thing. Yeah. And it's a prefact. Yeah, so typically, the fundamental integral that we have to calculate in at least in abelian theories in the Wortland formalism is an endpoint integral where all endpoints are running over the full circle. You have this, what we call the universal exponential, linear in the Green's functions, between the various points. So this lambda square is usually at one loop, it's pi dot pj. At higher loops, it can become something more complicated. The prefactor will be a polynomial in the g dots, first derivative of the Green's function, which has the Signum's function. So the basic challenge is, how do you calculate integrals like this without actually splitting them into ordered sectors or making case distinctions for the remaining points? Yeah? Usually you would just start integrating over one variable, fixing the others, but even then to evaluate the signum functions, you would have to fix an ordering. So we know that once you start doing that, you lose all the advantage. So we don't want to do that. So what would a mathematician do? He would start with simple classes of integrals, start with polynomials, and then go to exponentials, etc. The simplest non-trivial integrals are what we call chain integrals. And here you see if you integrate a product of g dots, where the indices form a chain, then you get a Bernoulli polynomial, do the same with the GFs, you get an Euler polynomial. We'll say more about this in a moment. Yeah, you can have an integral that is actually totally trivial in a given sector, like this one. But no computer will actually give you this nice formula, because he will split it into various sectors, and he will never be able to recombine the results into this. Yeah. And then there's also the issues that at 3 point already, the various g dots are not algebraically independent anymore. So generally, it is also possible to write down polynomials and g dots and g that are actually zero, but in each ordered sector for a different reason. Uwe Müller has studied the algebra of these polynomials. Now, some years ago, I solved the general polynomial problem in a recursive way by deriving this formula here. And so when you just want to integrate out one variable over the circle, you calculate the integral u with any ordering of the remaining u1 to un. And you have g dots to arbitrary powers, then this formula tells you how to remove that, how to do this one integral, and write the result again in terms of the g dot functions of the remaining points as a polynomial. So applying this recursively, obviously you can calculate any integral you want if it's just polynomial. Now, why do we see Bernoulli numbers and Bernoulli polynomials here? Well, that is because, remember, we started with path integrals that go over periodic functions, and then we had to fix the zero mode, and that takes out the constant function. So we are naturally now in the Hilbert space of periodic functions orthogonal to the constant functions. Actually, being orthogonal to the constant function makes a big difference because it makes the ordinary nth derivative invertible. And the nth, the inverse of the nth derivative in the space of periodic functions without the zero mode is essentially a Bernoulli polynomial, except you have some signum here in the odd case. And the zero's power is special because it's not the delta function, but delta minus one because of the zero mode subtraction. That's what represents the unit operator now. Yeah. it's curious that this formula as it stands, in fact, you can never find in any book on functional analysis or integral operators. In many books, you can find the formula for the Fourier series of the Bernoulli polynomials, which is actually equivalent to this formula if you assume that x is positive, yeah? But it misses all the fun stuff at x equals zero, the signum and the delta, that actually give you a nice closed algebra of integral operators on the circle. Yeah, for that reason, in this formalism, Bernoulli numbers, Bernoulli polynomials appear all over the place. For example, years ago, with our previous speaker, Gerald, we were calculating the two-loop self-dual or Heisenberg-Lagrangian, and from that we got the corresponding photon amplitudes in the low energy limit with all equal helicities. You see there are at one loop, this amplitude would essentially be a Bernoulli number. Well, there's some stuff here which takes care of the momenta and polarizations. That's just spin helicity stuff. But the coefficients are just Bernoulli numbers, and the two loop you start seeing folded sums of Bernoulli numbers. And that's a story I want to tell because it somewhat involves Dirk, because I was just visiting the IHES when we were doing this. And actually, we had actually two formulas for this two-loop effective Lagrangian, which both involved Bernoulli numbers, but they actually looked very different. So I asked Dirk, who can help and see tell us whether this is already known, is there some known identity which allows us to identify these two formulas? And he said that only Richard Stanley could help with this. So we wrote a letter to Richard Stanley, and after a couple of weeks, he indeed told us that this equivalence between these two versions of the expansion coefficients of the two-loop Heisenberg Lagrangians are equivalent to Euler's identity, to combining Euler's identity for the Bernoulli number, which is very well known, with Mickey's identity, which at that time was considered the most non-trivial identity known for Bernoulli numbers. So we learned from Richard Stanley that actually Bernoulli number identities that involve only Bn over n factorial are usually easy because most likely you can get them from the generating function. But identities that involve Bn over n are considered difficult. And Mickey's identity involves actually both. And it was considered very mysterious at the time. And actually it turned out at about the same time, Faber and Ripante published a similar formula, which they found in a string theory calculation and couldn't prove actually. They guessed that they couldn't prove it, since they asked Zagier, and Zagier actually managed to prove it. And then this, after getting this information by Richard Stanley, and Wiesen figured out how to use the Wörthmann formalism as a guiding principle to not only give a unified proof of both identities, Mickey and Faber, Andere Bande Zagier, and also we generalized them in various ways at the quadratic level, we generalized them to the cubic level, and we in fact pointed out a systematic construction of such identities to arbitrary orders. And only that, as far as I know, so far nobody has really done this. And that's not something we can ask our students to do, unfortunately. Anyway, coming back to my real topic, after settling the problem of integrating an arbitrary polynomial, now we would like to attack the problem of including the exponential factors, which is much more difficult. And here it makes sense to go back to the simplest case, so the scalar case. So we have the pure exponential factors, no prefactors. This formula was apparently written down for the first time in Polyakov's book. And that means we are now talking about the same off-shell scalar functions, which, for example, appeared in Andrei Davidichev's talk. Now remember that on-shell, that stuff is easy nowadays, but off-shell still not. And in fact, not many people even want to work on such things, like Andrei Davidichev, Tor Riemann, Oleg Tarasov, actually all have worked on the 3 and 4 point functions, and they all agree that in the 3 point case, you need the hypergeometric functions 2f1 and the Appel function f1. In the 4 point case, you need additionally what is called a Lauri-Cella-Serran function. So at least one knows in principle what one is looking for. Yeah, this looks deceptively simple. Yeah. The same formula can also be written down for the effective action. Yeah. In that case, in fact, it becomes more general because for the effective action, there's actually no reason to assume that it's phi cube. It could be as well any self-interaction. So here's a closed formula for the effective action. And of course, here, normally people don't talk about hypergeometric functions. What they do is they just expand in powers of these derivatives. And then they collect terms of equal mass dimension. And that gives you the heat kernel expansion. Still under the T-integral, you can do, doing the T-integral doesn't make any sense because it just creates inverse powers of the masses, yeah, and moreover, it would start depend on the space-time dimension. Well, these operators are not. So if you would want to do a very brute force approach to calculating the effective action in phi cube theory, you would now just expand all the exponentials. And you would have this integral here with all possible powers of all possible Green's functions. And again, this is an integral that is, any particular such integral is totally trivial, of course, but to obtain a closed form expression for arbitrary n and arbitrary exponents is a quite formidable challenge. It's only recently that we have made progress, in fact, towards doing this. Namely, the essential idea is actually to take each exponential factor and not directly expand it in powers of the Green's function, but rather in inverse powers of derivatives. Yeah. So if you take this exponential and you ask yourself, what coefficients do I get if I actually expand it in the matrix elements of the inverse derivatives on the circle, you get actually the following formula, which involves the 2n Bernoulli polynomial minus its coincidence limit, which is the corresponding Bernoulli number, And then it involves an odd Hermite polynomial. And yeah, you can integrate this formula from 0 to 1, and you get a formula for the error function, which actually expands it in terms of Bernoulli numbers and Hermite polynomials. And yeah, if you see this, you would assume that it must be known to mathematicians, but so far we have not been able to find it in the literature. So if anybody here in the audience has seen that formula, I would be happy to know about it. So now let's see how to use this formula. In the three-point case, in the three-point case, we have three exponential factors. On each, you apply this expansion. And now we have to remember that the space we are working on is such that you're always orthogonal to constants. Yeah, that means also that these matrix elements that involve the Bernoulli numbers actually become zero when integrated on either side. That means we can say that if I want to use this factor here, I must also use this one and use this one and form a closed cycle so as not to have any, let's say, loose end that would integrate to zero. So if we look at the most non-trivial case where we take the product of these three, then you get this integral and then you use a completeness relation, yeah, to convert this into a trace. But the trace of inverse derivatives in the space is again a Bernoulli number. Yeah. So without any real work, what you get is a closed formula for what before we called I3, this arbitrary exponents ABC, where you now have these finite sums appear. You have coefficients H that come from the Hermite polynomials. And here you have Bernoulli numbers. And yeah, so we can essentially see already the general structures that we are going to get. Only that it's starting from 4-point, we will not immediately be able to do all the integrals using completeness, because at 4-point will have integrals where the variable which you want to integrate actually appears in three factors. Yeah? That's what we call a cubic Wortmann vertex. But now it actually paid off that many years ago, actually, with Uwe Müller, we constructed precisely vertices like this when we actually tried to build a kind of a toy Wortmann quantum field theory where an arbitrary multiple zeta value can be encoded in a Feynman diagram. And an arbitrary identity between multiple zeta values can be derived by performing integration by parts on those Feynman diagrams. Yeah, because it's exactly the same procedure that we need here. Remember that delta to the power zero gives a delta function minus a constant. So what we do is, we do integration by parts, lowering one indices and raising the others until one index becomes zero. That happens here. When that index becomes zero, then you have a delta function that kills the integral, or you have minus one that doesn't kill the integral, but at least it removes that factor. And then the remaining factors already have involves integration variable only twice. So then you can actually do the integration like you did in the two-point case. Yeah. So it becomes a very simple combinatorial problem. So we can actually foresee that we should be able to get closed formulas for these coefficients in, not only for 3 or 4, but probably for 5 or 6 point. And then of course, there is the question, how do we get back to the standard description in terms of hypergeometric functions? Like these coefficients must be summed over and they must give known hypergeometric functions, but there are no formulas known for hypergeometric functions that involve Bernoulli numbers and the coefficients as far as I know. So this is, we will need some unknown identities to do that. Yeah. And also previous experience, this our work with Gerald and others has shown that having Bernoulli numbers is always nice also when you want asymptotic estimates, because the Bernoulli numbers are related to theta of 2n, which rapidly converges to 1. So you have a very rapid convergence of the Bernoulli numbers to this simple factor here. So it might be interesting for getting the large n asymptotics of the one loop endpoint functions. Yeah, and then of course we would like to go back to gauge theory, put the prefactor polynomial and eventually back to multiloop. All right, that's all. Happy birthday, Dirk.
Thank you, Christian. Thank you. If you have questions, please feel free to unmute yourselves and raise your hand. I was just wondering the expansion you showed at the very end with this mid polynomials. You said that you did this in the phi cubed scalar case.
Yeah, these coefficients appear when you take the standard one loop endpoint diagram, yeah?
Yeah.
Or equivalently the effective action.
But that was in the scalar theory, right?
In the scalar theory, yeah. In any gauge theory, you will have some prefactors involving G dots, yeah.
But this idea of this kind of expansion, is it useful in any way also in the QED case, or does it just not apply?
Well, I'm mostly interested in the QED case, yeah. But but we have to go step by step, yeah. In fact, yeah, in the 1990s with Michael Schmidt and Danny Fliegner, we wasted a lot of time doing multi-loop calculations that never worked out because we didn't understand that to calculate these integrals, you have to develop your own methods, yeah. Mm-hmm. You shouldn't try to use too much of the known stuff.
Yeah, but it seems like you're making quite some progress. So I'm excited to see what's coming up. We have a question from David.
Well, it's a comment, really. It's a thank you for reminding us of the work that Dirk did with Bob Del Borgo and me in 1995. Now, the other day in the chat room, we had a wonderful tribute from Bob to Dirk. It's very moving. I think this is an opportunity for us, Dirk and me, to give our appreciation to Bob. And you put your finger exactly on the place where Bob Del Borgo's wisdom showed when you said that we also not only did 3 and 4 root calculations in spinner QED, but in scalar QED, where you would think there would be extra diagrams from seagulls. But Bob told us no. So, I was all set to draw 21 extra diagrams, and he said, no, you can represent your scalar by a spinner using the Duffin-Kemmer-Pettiard formula. And all I had to do was to take my code and just change the propagator of the spinner. So that's a wonderful example. And that was of how you really benefit when you have a senior collaborator.
Well, actually, I was suspecting you would talk about this tomorrow in your Tasmanian adventures.
I've not chosen to, which is why I've mentioned it now, but it was wonderful to have a very wise older collaborator who has still continued to be productive and focused and clear-minded, well above my modest age of 73. So Dirk has a longer period of intellectual activity to look forward to if he can manage as well as Bob has done.
Thank you for sharing this.
May I have a question?
Sure.
Hi, Christian. Thanks for very good presentation. So it's not a question, but a comment. So I think I have the formula you were looking for this error function in terms of Hermite polynomials.
Oh, that's, well, yes.
Yes, and yep, if you allow me to share my screen, so I will show you the paper.
There's a formula in terms of Hermite polynomials, but I haven't seen one involving Bernoulli.
Yes, so it's actually in Journal of Chemical Physics of 1999. So I can send you this paper, but I can show also to everyone.
That's great. That's great.
You can also put a link in the chat.
I downloaded it in a complicated way, so it's...
Well, maybe then you shouldn't show it on a video recorded seminar.
Right, but Christian, I will send it to you.
We can do that privately.
Right, right.
Has it been used for something in that paper?
It's just called Hermite polynomial expansions of the error function and related F0 of W integral.
Oh,
it's in Journal of Chemical Physics.
Thank you, Andre. This sounds like exactly the kind of interesting connection observation that only happens at conferences when people listen to each other. Let's thank every speaker of this afternoon session and the evening session again.